Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Shenkel United Church of Christ, where we cringe with the sound. No, where no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here at worship with us. This morning, I don't have any particular announcements. Should we announce the ice cream social?
Yes.
Because that changed. When is that? The 14th?
14th of August. Yeah, 14th of August.
Okay. So, ice cream social, which is a little bit of a fundraiser, right?
Yep.
Usually for mission, will be on August 14th. So, after worship on that Sunday. It was changed because on August 7th, we're going to be having a baptism. And then and the family will be doing the social hour. So that's what's happening coming up in August. I know we just started July, but
also, Susan,
we're looking ahead.
Hopefully this week, Louise and I will be going down to Boscov's to pick up the Friends Helping Friends cards that we will sell for $5. You can go in the day of the shopping and purchase anything you want. Shenkel keeps the $5 for the coupon. And last year we earned it was like close to $500 because we get 100 coupons, sell them for $5, and we get to keep that $5 now. Hopefully, if everything goes okay this week, we will go down and pick up the coupons.
And do you have a date when that happens?
That's
October.
In October.
Usually around
okay.
The 17th.
Yeah, I thought it was in October. Okay, so you're going to be picking up those Boscov mm-hmm. coupons this week. So that will happen in October, but just so you know, you have that much time to buy the coupons from Tibby and Louise. Okay, great. Thank you. And our mission partners for Global Ministries today is Costa Rica, and Wally Berman is our Global Ministries partner there, and he works at the Latin American Biblical University. And they had 9 graduates in June, and their graduates have been going on to minister in El Salvador and Costa Rica and Panama, you know, all the little countries in Central America there. And Wally is actually working to digitize the thesis papers, dissertations of former students, so that they'll be in the library and can be useful to students who are coming on and to whoever would, you know, when they're digitized, then they're just available for everyone. So that's part of his work with the university there. So we'll be remembering him in prayer and the people of Costa Rica. So if there are no other announcements that people are aware of for the community, let us have a word of prayer. Loving God, we give thanks for this beautiful day that you have given to us. We give thanks for this holiday weekend, for this opportunity to be here in the grove and enjoy the bird song and the breeze and just being present with one another and reminded of your presence all around us. We ask for your blessing in our time together on each one of us. May your Spirit's presence be felt and experienced in our time together today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So for our choral introit, we are going to do what we did last week. Susan is going to play the phrase, and then we'll sing it. That seemed to work better than trying to divide up the group.
Spirit God, fall upon us now.
Spirit of God moves among us, binding us in covenant with faithful people of every time and place. The Spirit moves within us, empowering us to proclaim the gospel to all people. The Spirit moves through us, making us channels of God's love. As we gather to worship, we open ourselves to the Spirit of the living God, made known to us in Jesus Christ. Amen. To examine our faithfulness to God's covenant with us. God, in whose presence we gather, promises us grace and pardon when we acknowledge our weakness and shame. Let us confess our sin to God. Eternal God, whose word is a lamp for our feet and a light for our path, we recognize and confess that we have failed to respond fully to your gracious presence in our lives. Through Jesus Christ, you have offered us new life, fulfillment, and the freedom to serve you. We confess that we are captive to sin, that our sin binds us with false pride, and that the wrong we do is made worse by the good we leave undone. Reconcile us to you and to all people. God of mercy, forgive all our sin and strengthen us anew for life as you intended, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Hear the good news. Our sins are forgiven.
Morning. Lord, may the words of my mouth, meditation, and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, my Lord, my God, my Redeemer, and my Healer. Amen. Our gospel lesson this morning is taken from Matthew. No, it's not. It's taken from Luke. Luke chapter 10, verses 1 through 11, and then 16 to 20. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. he told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals. Do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. If not, I will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking whatever they give you. For the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and you are welcomed, eat what is offered to you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, go into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town, even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet,' as a warning to you. Be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near. Whoever listens to you listens to me. Whoever rejects you rejects me. But whoever rejects me rejects him who sent me." The 72 returned with joy and said, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." He replied, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." Our song is Psalm 66. To God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, "How awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to you. They sing the praise of your name. Come see what God has done, his awesome deeds for mankind. He turned the sea into dry land. They pass through the waters on foot. Come, let us rejoice in him. He rules forever by his power. His eyes watch the nations. Let not the rebellious rise up against him. Praise our God, all peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard. He has preserved our lives and kept our feet from slipping." Here is the reading of this portion.
Our third reading this morning is from the book of 2 Kings, chapter 5. Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Syria, was a great man and in high favor with his master, because by him the Lord had given victory to Syria. The man, though a mighty warrior, suffered from leprosy. Now the Syrians, on one of their raids, had taken a young girl captive from the land of Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my lord were with the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." So Naaman went in and told his lord just what the girl from the land of Israel had said. And the king of Syria said, "Go then, and I will send along a letter to the king of Israel." He went, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of garments. He brought the letter to the king of Israel, which read, "When this letter reaches you, know that I have sent to you my servant Naaman, that you may cure him of his leprosy." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to give death or life that this man sends word to me to cure a man of his leprosy?" Just look and see how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me. But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent a message to the king. Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me, that he may learn that there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and halted at the entrance of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, Go wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean. But Naaman became angry and went away, saying, I thought that for me he would surely come out and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, and would wave his hand over the spot and cure the leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean? He turned and went away in a rage. But his servants approached and said to him, Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you not have done it? How much more when all he said to you was, Wash and be clean? So he went down and immersed himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. His flesh was restored like the flesh of a young boy, and he was clean. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So my plans for this morning changed over the week. And because of some reading that I did. So I want to share with you this morning an article that I read in the Christian Century by a Jewish man, Yehiel Popko. And doesn't really have anything to do with the scriptures that we read today, except perhaps, you know, the sending part, because we are still sent forth, and that part is true. But the title of his article is called An Attack on God's Image. And so I'll just warn you ahead of time, or maybe I should just make clear right now. So he puts, because he's a Jewish writer, he puts in some Hebrew phrases or words that then he also translates for us. So just bear with me, and if I think there's something that people will not understand, I will elaborate a little more on that, okay? Because this is a little bit of a scholarly article, but it's very thought-provoking, and for me it was very thought-provoking and caused me to change what I wanted to do this morning for our worship service. In Buffalo, New York, 10 people created in the image of God, all of them black, were killed last month in a racially motivated attack. The phrase, the image of God, Tselem Elohim, which is the Hebrew, but we're more familiar with the Latin, Imago Dei. Probably many of you have heard that one. The image of God is found so regularly upon our lips as Jews and the lips of our Christian neighbors that we should pause and think again about its origin and its meaning. The reason the Torah prohibits making an image of God is because the Kadosh Baruch Hu, the Holy One, blessed be He, has made an image of His very self, the human being. As Rabbi Akiva, who was martyred by Hadrian in 137, taught, precious are humans because they are created in God's image. Beloved is the human, for the human was created in the image of God, says Rabbi Akiva in the Mishnah. The Mishnah is the first major written collection of Jewish oral tradition. So it's not our Bible, but the Jewish people use it alongside the Torah being the first 5 books of our scriptures. Okay, they use the Mishnah because it's the oral tradition. They work together for the Jewish people. So Rabbi Akiva, what he taught orally has been written down in the Mishnah. And this is what he says. A greater love was bestowed upon the human, for the human is created in the image. For it was written, in the image of God made he the human, Adam. thus, according to Rabbi Akiva, not only is the Adam, the human, created in the divine image, which is a factual determination of the Torah, but the fact that the human is created by God is the very reason the human is beloved by God. Creation is an act of love. Hence, Rabbi Akiva emphasizes that the human was accorded a greater love. All the commandments of the Torah are grounded in this fact. The development of civilization is impossible and unthinkable without this fact. For all their wisdom and commitment to ethics, Aristotle, Socrates, Plato, Kant, were unable to develop a more pure and enduring foundation for the sanctity and dignity of the human. The human is the image of God. Indeed, for that reason, the Torah commands, whoever sheds the blood of a human, by human shall their blood be shed, for in his image did God make the human. The buffalo killer, whose name should never again be mentioned, set out, if one dare say it, to murder God. Political scientist Ryan Burge, without whose scholarship it's quite difficult to understand what's happening in the religious and political landscape of America, demonstrates in his 2021 book, The Nuns, so not the Catholic nuns, The Nuns, N-O-N-E-S. Those are the people who do not claim any religious affiliation. Okay, that's been a term that has risen called The Nuns. So when I say that, think, visualize N-O-N-E-S, The Nuns. 73% of that group of people, the nuns, have no higher education. A significant portion of them leave high school and become what Burge calls loners. Young men and women who participate in the military or attend college have an opportunity for moral development, which happens in human relationships, fostered by group participation. The loners are at a critical moment in life, not just socially isolated, they're also ethically and morally isolated. Burge ominously goes on to explain that this is the group that gives us mass shooters. It must also be noted that these people are not afflicted with incapacitating mental illness. They have freely chosen evil. Stephen Ray, former president of Chicago Theological Seminary, and some of you are acquainted with Stephen Ray's writing from our curriculum on white privilege, he has commented on Burge's observation about the nuns, noting that such loners are enabled by what he calls structures of permission. When prominent figures in American society give voice to ideas and sentiments such as, they will not replace us, white supremacist loners then are authorized to behave as they do. I believe that one of these structures of permission was provided by Senators Ted Cruz and Josh Hawley during the Supreme Court confirmation hearing of Judge Ketanji Brown Jackson. Cruz and Hawley did not treat her as someone created in the image of God, nor did they treat her as an American citizen, embodying the best in America, or as a judge possessed of significant professional accomplishments born of a first-rate education, a first-rate intellect, and a first-rate ethical moral sensibility, not to speak of deeply held Christian beliefs. Instead, these two mean-spirited senators treated Jackson as less than human, and they did so in the presence of her parents and her children. This is but one recent example of leaders providing a structure of permission for violent loners to act upon their racism and hate. Following the end of prophecy, the Jewish tradition no longer attempts to address the question, why, when horrific and evil events overtake us. And this, I think, is an important piece because that's always our first question, isn't it? Why? Why would these things happen? So our Jewish brothers and sisters no longer ask or try to address that question. Instead, they seek to answer a different set of questions. Now that we have been subjected to such events, what must we do? How should we do it? With whom should we do it? When and where should we do it? Much more proactive questions to address. Something that we can do. This has happened. This is our reality now. Now what can we do? One thing we should do after the murders in Buffalo is mourn. Generally, mourning means to give cathartic expression to loss, sadness, anger, grief, pain, and weeping. But Moses ben Maimon, the foremost rabbinic legal authority and philosopher in the Middle Ages, commonly known as Maimonides, some of you may have heard of him, departs from the popular sense of the purpose of mourning and gets at a greater truth. For him, the purpose of mourning is to stand for Kavod Habriot, the glorious dignity of every human created in the image of God. The purpose of mourning for Maimonides is to stand for the glorious dignity of every human created in the image of God. Every death is an assault on the dignity of the human created in God's image, or as John Donne wrote in his Meditation 17, any man's death diminishes me because I am involved in mankind. Maimonides teaches that the obligation to mourn falls first and foremost on immediate relatives, then the rest of the family, and then the neighborhood and wider community. All who join in that mourning, in that stand for human dignity, are summoned to be with the mourner. They are not summoned to deliver sermons. They are not summoned to say wise words of consolation. For there are no wise words of consolation in the face of the violation of human dignity. Rather, they are obligated simply to be with the mourner. That is the essence of comfort and consolation in the Jewish tradition, to sit with the mourner and to say nothing, so that the mourner knows that he or she is not alone in standing for the human dignity of their loved one. Jeffrey Weidlinger's new book, In the Midst of Civilized Europe, is about the pogroms that took place during the Ukrainian national uprising between 1919 and 1921, so a little over 100 years ago. Approximately 100,000 Jews were murdered. These pogroms were spontaneous and popular. They were not perpetrated with an order from the top. They were an expression of popular sentiment. And that popular sentiment was expressed in a saying that was on the lips of the perpetrators as they went about their murdering. No more Jews. They will not replace us is of a piece with no more Jews. And in the face of they will not replace us, I am obligated to declare and act upon four simple words to my black friends, colleagues, neighbors, and community members. You are not alone. There is so much going on in our society right now, and has been for some time. And I wanted to allow us the space and the time to mourn, to stand for the dignity, the glorious dignity of every human being created in God's image. from the 10 people in Buffalo to the 19 children and two teachers in Texas, to the 53 Latin American people in San Antonio, Texas, to the people in our cities who are being killed, shot, to mourn dreams that you thought would happen, dreams for your children that aren't happening, for relationships. I don't need to name all of the reasons that we have to mourn. People in the Ukraine, I just want to open this space for us to have some silence and perhaps maybe you want to pray. Maybe you want to name, if it's helpful for you to name something. You can either stay in your seat and name it aloud there, or you can come to a microphone. This is our space. I believe if there is a place for us to be able to mourn, it should be in our faith community. And my apologies to the people who will be remote. It's not very helpful to have this quiet space when you're just worshiping remotely. But let's just let it be what it is. I think one of the hardest places to be is in between. So sometimes it's easier just to fall into anger and sorrow and rage, or just forget it all and be joyful and happy. But I think that we're called to hold those together, the joy and the sorrow. And I have just a liturgy here for embracing both joy and sorrow. Do not be distant, O Lord, lest we find this burden of loss too heavy and shrink from the necessary experience of grief. Do not be distant, O Lord, lest we become so mired in yesterday's hurt that we miss entirely the living gifts this day might hold. Let us neither ignore our pain, pretending all is okay when it isn't, nor coddle and magnify our pain so that we dull our capacity to experience all that remains good in this life. For joy that denies sorrow is neither hard-won, nor true, nor eternal. It is not real joy at all. And sorrow that refuses to make space for the return of joy and hope in the end becomes nothing more than a temple for the worship of our own woundedness. So give us strength, O God, to feel this grief deeply, never to hide our hearts from it. And give us also hope enough to remain open to surprising encounters with joy, as one on a woodland path might stumble suddenly into dabblings of golden light. Amidst the pain that lades these days, give us courage, O Lord. Courage to live them fully, to love and to allow ourselves to be loved, to remember, grieve, and honor what was, to live with thanksgiving in what is, and to invest in the hope of what will be. Be at work gilding these long heartbreaks with the advent of new joys, good friendships, true fellowships, unexpected delights. Remind us again and again of your goodness, your presence, your promises. For this is who we are, a people of the promise, a people shaped in the image of the God whose very being generates all joy in the universe, yet who also weeps and grieves its brokenness. So we, your children, are also at liberty to lament our losses, even as we simultaneously rejoice in the hope of their coming restoration. Let me learn now, O Lord, to do this as naturally as the inhale and exhale of a single breath. To breathe out sorrow, to breathe in joy, to breathe out lament, to breathe in hope, to breathe out pain, to breathe in comfort, to breathe out sorrow, to breathe in joy, to breathe out joy. In one hand we grasp the burden of our grief, while with the other we reach for the hope of grief's redemption. And here between the tension of the two, between what was and what will be, in the very is of now, let our hearts be surprised by, shaped by, warmed by, remade by the same joy that forever wells within and radiates from your heart, O God. Amen. Now I invite you to sing kind of a well-known chorus. Is it a chorus?
I call it a chorus.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
Thank you.
change of pace to join me in saying these ancient words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now we come to our prayer time. We will be remembering our members who are on our list in the bulletin this week, along with Barry Peterman, and he still has some tests that he's undergoing to find out what really happened with his lungs, and Lisa Yoakum and her family. For Barb, it's good that she double-bubbled today. She was at the early service and is doing it again, and she will have another treatment on Thursday. It's not the trial, but the another treatment. And also, Stacy asked for prayer. Stacy Kine, her kidney, she's having trouble with her kidney function, so let's hold her in prayer. And Tootie as well, she's
still undergoing testing.
Still getting testing. It's kind of a long road, isn't it?
It is.
For them to pinpoint what it is so they know what to do.
But I have faith, and I have God on my side, is all I gotta say.
That's right, and that helps a lot, doesn't
it?
Does. Faith helps a lot in these times. And also we continue to pray for all those who live with the challenges of mental health issues, and for Costa Rica and for our partner Wally Berman. Are there other prayer requests that you would like to lift up? For Heather, yes, we'll continue to pray for Heather and her ongoing needs.
I have an update on Ethel. I talked with Sue this week, and they have taken her away from the villa. They've closed down her apartment at the villa.
I'm not surprised.
She's at Phoebe right now, but they're trying to get her into Chestnut Knoll or Walnut Woods, and she has developed congestive heart failure. So they're not quite sure where she's going to be able to be moved, but sometimes she's at Phoebe, sometimes she's back in the hospital, so it's been hard to make a connection with her, but that's the latest.
Okay, thank you.
And a prayer of joy, a new step-great-granddaughter was born yesterday. Her name is Morgan Elizabeth.
Morgan Elizabeth was born yesterday, a step-great-granddaughter. That's great. It's always fun to have good news, and births are good news. So,
prayers for the people of Eastwick who, after a couple of years, still don't have their homes fixed, and for the leaders who are taking care of the project on the other end.
Okay, we'll continue to pray for the people of Eastwick, and also that's a reminder, Gary and Dan and I are going down this coming Saturday, right?
And Lynn as well.
And Lynn's gone. Okay, good, we got another one. But it's been... We're still doing work from 2 years ago, right? So imagine your house with those flooding issues from a hurricane 2 years ago. So that's what the people of Eastwick are living with. And so we'll continue to pray for them and for the people who are working on the other end and, you know, inviting us in, finding work that we can do with our skill levels. You know, but they're happy for volunteers to come, and so we'll continue to pray for them. Thank you, Gary.
Susan, could you repeat what Sandy said about
Oh, I'm sorry.
Ethel.
Thank you for reminding me. Yeah, I sometimes forget that. Yes, an update on Ethel. They have Ethel Miller. They have closed out her apartment in the villas. So right now she's at Phoebe Burke's. She was in the hospital this week. I did see her because I got an email. So this is a note for any of you, if you happen to go to, especially Reading Hospital, when you are admitted, if you say you're a member of Shenkel UCC, they will send me an email that you were in the hospital. So that's kind of a nice thing, but they won't do that if you don't say that you're, you know, have a specific church home or anything. But so I did get an email that she was in. She's 91, so I went the first day because I don't know. I mean, she's been in and out. So they're not sure. They're trying to get her into Chestnut Knoll or Walnut Ridge, one of those in Boyertown. So that's kind of up in the air. She has congestive heart failure now. And that Sandy has a new step great granddaughter, just born, Morgan Elizabeth. Okay. Let's go to God in prayer, shall we? Loving God, we give thanks again for this day and for this time that we have had together in your presence and in one another's presence. We thank you for the privilege of standing for the glorious dignity of all human beings that are created in your image. And we lift so many of them before your throne of grace who are in need of your hand of healing and wholeness. We lift up especially Barry Peterman and pray that the doctors would be able to discover what was the root cause of his issues. For Lisa, for healing and wholeness for her, and for blessings of courage and strength for her family as they continue to be advocates for her and walk with her through these difficult days. For Barb and her upcoming treatment on Thursday, we pray that it would be effective in fighting her disease. We lift up Stacy and ask for healing and wholeness for her, for Tootie and for her doctors, that you would give them wisdom and understanding to know what next steps to take. For Heather and her ongoing difficulties with her health, we ask for healing for her and that she may be able to continue her treatment for Crohn's disease. We lift up Ethel and pray that you would bless her and encourage her in these times of transition and for her family members in the unknown, all of the unknowns that she is facing, that they're facing with her. We ask for your grace and encourage and help for her. We give thanks for the birth of Morgan Elizabeth and ask for your blessings for her family. We continue to lift up all those who live with the challenges of mental illness and all that that means in their lives and the lives of their families. We ask for courage for their family members who accompany them and for an openness to medication that would help and therapy that would be helpful, that you would continue to bless and guide each one as they deal with their circumstances. We pray for the people of Costa Rica and for Wally and his ministry there, especially for the Latin American Biblical University, and ask for your blessings for them as they've finished out 1 year and send off graduates to their home countries to take your love and your compassion and minister in those other Central American countries. We lift up the people of Eastwick and can't imagine the long wait that so many of them have had to have help coming to recover from the flooding that happened 2 years ago. And we pray that you would bless those who are working so hard in their neighborhoods to bring help. We thank you for all the groups who have volunteered and ask for continued blessing and guidance. And we give thanks that we can be a part of the people who are helping. We pray that our work also would be effective and we would be an encouragement to the people in whose homes we work. We continue to lift up the people of Ukraine and know that they continue to fight this war that is being waged against them, and so many have lost so much, and there is so much trauma for the children as well as the adults, and we ask for your grace and your help. And most of all, we pray for peace, for an end to the warfare. And we pray for our own country and the needs of our country, even as we celebrate its birthday this weekend. We acknowledge the problems that exist, that are, and ask for your wisdom and help, that we might know what to do and how to do it and with whom to do it to make a difference. And we thank you that you have given to us a prayer that we can always pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So once again, I thank you for your faithfulness in supporting financially Shenkel's ongoing ministries. And this month, our Bill Boyer Scholarship Award is our monthly designation for your gifts. So we thank you for that. And I invite you to sing together our chorus that is our offering response. God, for all that you have given to us, and we give thanks that we have the opportunity to share out of our abundance. We ask your blessing on these offerings. May they be used to further your work of love and compassion in all the world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So we come to our communion time now. And as has become the custom during the pandemic, we're going to do it a little differently than we've done it before. You will be invited to come up to receive a piece of bread, and then there will be a cup. And so this month, we're asking you to, as soon as you receive the bread, you can eat your piece of bread, and then you'll move over. Pat will be holding the cups, and then you can take your cup and drink your cup right away. Because we are also offering healing prayer during communion. So Joan and Louise will be available. So I wanted you to not be still trying to hang on to your cup and your bread for all of us to commune together. So that's why we're doing it a little differently. But Louise and Joan will be available for after you have communion, before communion, to go to them and receive anointing and prayers for healing. And I think those are just a reminder too, we're not in a hurry. Okay, so don't worry about people coming after you. They will wait. And if you are not able to get up because the ground is uneven, and I recognize that, and you don't want to be walking around, we will come to you. Okay, so if there's any question of that, we will come to you. So we'll make sure that everyone is able to commune. Beloved in Christ, the gospel tells us that on the first day of the week, Jesus Christ was raised from death, appeared to Mary Magdalene, on that same day sat at the table with two disciples, and was known to them in the breaking of the bread.
This is
a joyful feast of the people of God. Men and women, youth and children, come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, and gather at Christ's table. This table is for all Christians who wish to know the presence of Christ and to share in the community of God's people. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give thanks to God Most High.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, gracious God, that you have given us this meal of bread and fruit of the vine, that through it you strengthen our faith and remind us that we belong to you. We give you thanks for all the people through all the ages who have shared this meal, who have followed Jesus, who have lived lives of compassion and of love. We honor them and we remember them, and we thank you most of all for Jesus, that you sent your Son to show us how to be in communion with you and with one another. We give you thanks for all those who have gone before us, and with them we praise your name by saying, Holy, 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 God of love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory, O God Most High. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God. Hosanna in the highest. We remember that on the night when Jesus was betrayed and deserted by his disciples, that he shared a meal with them in an upper room, and at that meal he blessed the bread and broke it and gave it to them, saying, This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave it to all of them, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of all sin. Drink this for the remembrance of me. And so we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ's death, O God, we proclaim. Christ's resurrection, we declare. Christ's coming, we await. Glory be to you, O God. Eternal God, we unite in this covenant of faith and ask for your blessing and your presence upon us as we share this meal. And we give you praise because you are able to make all things new. Be present with us as we share this meal and throughout all our lives, that we may know you as the Holy One, who with Christ and the Holy Spirit lives forever. Amen. Through the breaking of the bread, we participate in the body of Christ. And through the cup of salvation, we participate in the new life that Christ offers to us. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are now ready. Thank you. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of our Savior's presence in the simplicity and splendor of this holy meal. Unite us with all who are fed by Christ's body and blood, that we may remain faithfully proclaim the good news of your love, and that your universal church may be a rainbow of hope in an uncertain world. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. Now I invite you, if you are able, to stand if you would like to sing our final hymn, Let Us Talents and Tongues Employ. Into a new week. May you be encouraged to stand for the glorious dignity of every human being created in God's image. Sometimes that means mourning with those who mourn. Sometimes it means figuring out, what do we do now? With whom should we do it? And how should we do it? So go forth empowered to be Christ's hands and feet in the world so much in need. Go forth in the peace of Christ. But first, learn a new song. So we have a new song. How you played it during...
I did.
During offering, during communion, I heard it.
Yes, so they've already gotten a hint.
Okay, so you've had a hint. But how about if you play it again and then sure. We'll be able to sing it.
I'll just play your parts.
You'll get your chance.
Yeah.